Good morning again, everybody. I'm going to go ahead. It's 10 o'clock. Time of convening our Wednesday, March 23rd, 2016 State Election Board meeting. So let me again welcome you to the Macon office of the Georgia Secretary of State this morning. And our first order of business is our invocation and pledge of allegiance. And Mr. Worley is going to lead us in that this morning. Mr. Worley.
Dear Lord, thank you for bringing us safely here today. Please watch over us as we return to our homes. Please give the members of this board the wisdom to judge the issues before us fairly today. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Worley. All right, good morning again, everybody. I'm going to go ahead. It's 10 o'clock. Time of convening our Wednesday, March 23rd, 2016 State Election Board meeting. So let me again welcome you to the Macon office of the Georgia Secretary of State this morning. And our first order, our next agenda item is public comment. Do we have any public comment, Caleb? Those of you that came in right when we were starting, we do allow for 2 minutes of public comment on issues not related to the cases that we'll be calling today. First, we have Mr. Rhymes. You will, I will just let you speak at that mic there and just give us your name and address for the record, please. Welcome.
My name is George Boston Rhymes, 5004 Oak Drive, Valdosta, Georgia. And I'm with the Get To Free Press. And my 2 minutes, I just want to use it to highlight, because I can't get into detail within 2 minutes. But Mr. Secretary and all you important people that are dealing with voting rights here in the state of Georgia, I just want to say, and I want to be on record, that there are major problems throughout the state of Georgia that I have identified that the news media mainstream will not report. I have been reporting it, and you can see it on Boston GBR YouTube channel. In Brooks County, Georgia, we have major problems in voting, as well as trying to remove black mayors across the state. I'm working about 16 cities, Mr. Secretary. Quitman, Meigs, Lumpkin, Warrington, Gordon, Davisboro, Homerville. In Homerville, we have a sitting elected city council person who has two homestead exemptions, one in the state of Florida, one in Lowndes County, Georgia, and he's holding office in Homerville, Georgia. These are impediments to the voting rights process, and across the state, the people and places that I've gone to, people are asking a question. What is the Secretary of State and others doing to resolve these problems that seem to impact and suppress the black vote throughout the state of Georgia? Also, Camilla, Georgia. I may not be able to call them all, but there's approximately 16 cities. And I believe that myself, a retired military veteran, I had no idea that this would be going on in 2016. To suppress, give the appearance of suppressing and controlling the black votes. And then after they get elected, the black mayors are seen to be under attack throughout the state. Now, I can prove this through videos. I go to all these cities at meetings. It's been documented, well documented. And so I'm gonna take my seat. I think my minute should be, 2 minutes should be up. And I already like to abide by the law because I'm a law-abiding citizen. Thank you, my beautiful Secretary, and to all of you who represent voting process in the state of Georgia, the United States of America. We have veterans here, and I do believe that they should have a right to vote without the impediments and suppression. Thank you so much for this space, my beautiful brothers and sisters.
Thank you for being here this morning.
Yes, sir. I should thank Mr. Rhymes for his service to
America. Absolutely. We appreciate your service as well.
Myself from any activity with the board until you get that straight.
Well, he's asking. What are you doing?
I'll be glad to give you an affidavit or a statement or whatever, but until that gets, you know, settled, I don't want anybody thinking that, you know, we're trying to do anything underhanded or above, you know.
I understand that, Ken. I understand it. But as a board member, we have to look into it or have someone look into it.
I understand.
So that's where it has to go from there. It needs to be looked into because I don't want that to fall back in my lap.
So in essence, then, I need to suspend myself from any activity with the election office until that gets settled.
What are you doing?
Excuse me, y'all. I was asked a question, and I'd like to respond to you because I am recording. What I'm doing is that I'm recording.
You know what? You should not be doing that without informing us ahead of time.
Okay, let me. You asked me a question. I want to answer, if you allow me. Will you let me answer my question?
Go ahead.
If this is indeed a public meeting, I have a right to do this. It has been proven over and over again in the courts. I go all to these cities, Lakeland, all around. This is what I do. So I'm just recording a public meeting. Now, if what is being discussed would have been determined by you, the chairman, or whoever, if it's possible, you all to go in an executive session to discuss your matters, which I think maybe should have been there, then I know the procedures, and I definitely would not try to come in at executive. But if it's a public meeting, I have a right to record and to record.
He's right.
And so I just answered your question, and that's my point.
All right. Well, we are going to call an executive session at this point. The rest of the meeting is adjourned.
That's not a reason.
Okay.
You know, in order for an executive session, you have to state the reason for it. There's only three reasons you're going into it. You have to have a motion to go into it. You have to tell us the reason you're going into it. And then when we come back, you have to tell us what was discussed. So,
and there must be a vote on it.
It's called legally the executive session. Anything other than that is sunshine.
Okay, so go ahead. What else? I just am feeling very threatened at this point and very just picked on and torn apart. For people who have worked so hard trying to put something good together.
This is the Ghetto Free Press, and I'm George Austin Rhines, and I just received the breaking news that we have a new mayor in Quitman, Georgia. Much like the Quitman 10 plus 2, Nancy Dennard being the first president of the Brooks County Board of Education, and now we have James Brown III, the first black African-American mayor of Quitman, Georgia. First of all, we acknowledge that black does not make it right, but right always make it right. We must understand that the Quitman 10 plus 2 brought Brooks County the first black majority in the history of that county. And as you know, the Quitman 10 plus 2 was brought upon charges of alleged voter fraud, and after nearly 3 years, only one have had their day in court, and it ended up a mistrial.
Time that the people in South Georgia know.
all your family that came down from New York and other places to congratulate you on your victory. As a graduate of Washington Street High School myself, from Brooks County, I say to you, as the Muslims say, Alhamdulillah. And to the Jews, I just say shalom to you. And as the Christians, I say peace and blessings be upon you and to all the great worthies that help you in your campaign.
The witnesses lied on the stand.
Yes, yes, yes.
The Georgia Bureau of Investigation lied on the stand.
Yes,
that's right.
Yes.
Falsified documents.
That's right.
Yes.
The Secretary of State lied on the stand.
Yes, sure did. Yes, yes.
Boone from the post office, who started this whole mess, lied on the stand.
Sure did.
Yes.
All to try to make these citizens look guilty. Accused of voter fraud. These citizens was arrested,
unceremoniously put in orange jumpsuits, their names splattered all over newspapers, the television, the radio, and this was only an indictment. An indictment is only an accusation. But yet these citizens were presumed guilty before there was even a trial. Amen. And we must understand that every citizen is presumed innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. When they was arrested, we thank God for the community that came together. And the first meeting was held at Bethlehem Church. We thank God for Bethel for opening their doors. I was a pastor there. We also like to thank our good friend Floyd Rowe. Stand up. God always has people in place when you need them the most.
Amen.
He is a stalwart in the civil rights movement. He knew what to do. He even named Equipment 10. Amen. He showed us how to get this movement organized. And we thank God for him. He's from the SCLC. Amen. We thank God for them and Tyrone Brooks coming down and helping us. Also, during this movement, the NAACP was started here. And that was to, there might be future cases that might come up, and we'll have an organization in place to make sure we can handle this situation. Now, the United States Constitution guarantees each person equal protection under the law. The United States Constitution guarantees that every person of our nation is presumed innocent until proven guilty in a court of law. The rights of these citizens were violated.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
And what is so, what angers me so, is the fact that Sister Latasha Head died with these accusations hanging over her head.
Yes, sir. Yes,
and
sir.
Yet there are still, with her, 11 people that still have to be tried. Mm. This case has been going on for 4 years.
Sir.
Now, you have to understand one thing, and that is, every person is entitled to a speedy trial. Their rights was violated. Now, why did it take over 4 years to bring these people to justice? It's because they didn't have a case.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
That's right.
They didn't have a case. They were hoping that they would take the plea. But when they didn't do that, they had to prove their case. And if you were in the courtroom, you would have seen one of the biggest fiascos you ever wanted to see in your life.
Oh, yes.
That's right.
Oh, yes.
The witnesses lied on the stand.
Yes, yes, yes.
The Georgia Bureau of Investigation lied on the stand.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
Falsified documents.
That's right.
Yes.
The Secretary of State lied on the stand.
Yes,
Boone from the post office, who started this whole mess, lied on the stand.
Yes.
All to try to make these citizens look guilty.
My Lord.
But thank God that we have a God who sits high.
Come on now.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
The sad thing about this case is Governor Deal, who's the leader of the state of Georgia, left the state capitol to come down here and suspend people who were elected to the school board.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
This election was certified.
Yes, sir.
And without due process of law.
That's right.
Every person is entitled to due process of law.
Yes. That's right.
But he's put it upon himself to suspend Dr. Nancy Danner, who has a doctor's degree.
Yes, sir.
Sister Diane Thomas, who has a master's degree.
Earned.
And yes. Sister Linda Troutman.
Yes, no one.
They treated us like, excuse me for saying us. Because I was just as angry as they were.
That's right. That's right.
Every citizen in Brooks County should have been angry.
You're upset.
Come on now.
Yes, sir.
For
yes,
the way they treated our citizens.
Yes, that's right. Sir.
But yet many people didn't get involved because, number one, you thought they was guilty because the white man said they were.
Woo! Woo! There it is! Woo! Woo! There it is! Come on now.
Woo! There it is!
That's all right.
That's it.
Woo!
And you're scared.
Come on now. That's it. That's it.
My question is, how are you going to get the horse back into the barn?
That's right.
These people's names have been tarnished, their reputation besmirched. They have been talked about, accused of different things. And now they are proven innocent. How are you going to get the horse back in the... How will you restore these people's good name and reputation? How are we going to do that? We need to look at that and see what we can do to help them restore their good name. One thing that most people didn't understand, and I'm getting ready to close, were that when the GBI, the Secretary of State, canvassed the community, they tried to strike fear in the heart of the black community.
Woo! Yes, sir! Yes, sir!
They didn't want you to vote.
That's right.
They especially didn't want you to vote absentee. Because those absentee ballots can be accounted for.
Yes, sir. Paper
That's
trail.
Right. Paper
this
trail.
Trial proved that there was corruption downtown.
That's right.
If it wasn't for the absentee ballots, it never would have been uncovered.
That's right.
Many people don't understand that when those incumbents were declared the winner that night and woke up and had lost the election that next day, it's because they didn't intend to count the absentee ballots.
That's right. That's right. Woo!
But God prevailed.
Amen.
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 The prosecution changed the wording on the ballots to prosecute Lula Smart. The language was not there in 2010. They changed it.
My Lord, my Lord.
That's right.
On the ballot to make it look like she was guilty. The prosecution suppressed evidence.
Yes, sir.
They hid evidence.
Show they did. Woo! I'm a witness.
Amen. Show them. Speak it. Tell the truth.
I believe that we ought to demand, as concerned citizens, that they drop the charges on every remaining member. What's so amazing is that Sister Dana and all of the workers on the poll had been trained.
Yes.
They knew what to do. But yet they tried to make it look like they were incompetent. But God prevailed.
Yes.
Amen.
Few of the thousands of this trial, and then I'm going to sit down.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I got angry when I looked. I didn't even vote absentee ballot that time. And here come the GBI and the Secretary of State knocking on my door.
Wow.
Wow.
But one thing that happened that most people don't understand is that you all shut them down.
Amen.
Amen.
You all shut them down.
Amen.
When you told them that we're not going to answer your question, we voted who we wanted to vote for, I did what I wanted to do, get out of my yard. Don't have to be afraid no longer.
All right. Amen.
It's so much I could go on, but I'm going
to tell the story.
Jesus.
I'm going to hear, but there were so many fallacies. And I hope and pray that we all learn a lesson from this.
Yes.
That we're not going to let anybody come in our community
no.
and disrespect right. our people. These were the leading citizens of our community that they
Amen.
Went after.
Amen.
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 If the head falls, the body. You kill the head, the body gonna
die.
But see, they didn't know Nancy Denner. And Diane. Miss Sharpman.
That's right.
And they didn't know.
They didn't know.
But I knew from the beginning, and that they were innocent from the start. I don't know about you, but I grew up in the 50s. I was born in 1952. Amen.
Amen.
And I know the tactics of the other man. They'll do anything to win.
Oh, yes, they will. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
But I want to say to you and to all of the people who prayed and supported the Quitman team, I know some of you wanted to be there, but you had to work. I know some of you could have been there, but you chose not to. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for just putting them up before God.
Amen.
And allowing God to use them. Whether you know it or not, God used them.
Yes. Yes, he did.
There was a gentleman that called me from San Francisco. And he said, what in the world are y'all doing out there? He got on our organization, NAACP, because they didn't come here. I'm angry. Because the president of the NAACP didn't show his face.
Tell it!
And I'm angry.
Tell it!
Now he's writing all kind of articles. Want to quit my 10 plus 2 to come up there and talk. Where was he when they needed him the most? That's a little bit of the history, and I'm going to close with this. The Get Out the Vote campaign of the Quitman 10 plus those who helped were the most brilliant campaign I have seen in my life. People voted who had never voted before in their life.
Amen.
People who couldn't make it to the polls. And they got beat to their own game.
Come on, man. That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
It was a brilliant campaign. It was well planned, well organized. And many other communities are looking at what the Quitman 10 plus 2 did. And they are doing the same thing in their communities.
Of course.
So we say, Quitman 10 plus 2, don't stop doing what you're doing.
Right now.
We're fast getting up. are you counsel? I told one of the white gentlemen that he was wondering how did the mayor get beat. And I told him that everybody who touched the Quitman 10,
yeah. Look out! Look out! Look out! There it is! There it is!
Amen. I don't know about y'all, but you ain't gonna mess with no.
Your voice comes in the cold. This is the Ghetto Free Press, and I'm George Boston Rhymes. Last Saturday, I was at the Moores Fort Bridge in Monroe, Georgia. Today, I decided to come to Brooks County, Georgia. And this is another lynching wherein 13 to 25 black Americans was lynched. The black mother, young woman, had her 18-month fetus cut from her womb. It fell to the ground. A white mob member took his boot and crushed the head of his black child. After using that hog knife to slash her wound open to take that baby, much like they took the baby from the mother, as you will see on this video. And I want you to know that this is a short version, but I intend to post the complete memorial service held by Representative Tyrone Brooks and others. Once again, we erected the Mary Turner and Lynching Campaign historic marker a few years ago. And I must give credit to my beautiful Caucasian brother, Professor Mark George from VSU. I call him a white right brother. Many whites have a choice. They can join in the black struggle, and after a year or decade, they can flip the script. They can return to their places of lodging. But some of us are committed to life, to do what is good, not only for our families, but for our local communities, the state of Georgia, the United States of America, in God's world. This sign, dedicated to the Mary Turner Week of Terror. We have people that have found the need to fire bullets into this marker. One, two, three, four, five. Now, I'm not going to say that those were five gunshots to carry on racism and hatred. Somebody just could have been driving along the highway and wanted to use their gun. But I'm gonna leave you with this. As you watch this video, you don't see where too many people talk about connecting the dots, as I have tried to do, to show the Justice Department under Attorney General Lynch that Eric Holder did a sorry job when it come down to promoting voting rights here in the state of Georgia. And somebody must say it. You have the Quitman 10 plus 2. Miss Lula Smart had a 19-day voting rights case. No news media in America, let me repeat, no news media in America was in the Brooks County Courthouse. Only me, the Ghetto Free Press. I reported it. But you don't see where nobody come and say, thank you, Brother Rhymes, or thank you, Ghetto Free Press. But guess what? They try to ignore the people who try to stand up for truth. And when they have events, they'll push the people who bring truth to you to the background as if though you don't exist. But all I'm going to say to you on the world stage is this. Somewhere I read, be careful how you entertain strangers, for many have entertained angels unaware. And so I'm going to say to you, as long as I am able, to give you truth. If the wicked, and I do mean the wicked, both black, white, Japanese, and everybody else, if the wicked cannot see the good of the righteous, then there's a great possibility that those people may be among those that cannot be and will not be found in the hereafter. Now down to the Moores Ford Bridge and what certain people in power in the state of Georgia are doing to circumvent the black vote and to remove black mayors from office. And yet, the American people will not stand up with 14 mayors in various cities, some wherein disgraceful voting rights laws are in shambles. And the Justice Department in the United States of America seem to not give a damn. And I know, because along with most all the civil rights leaders across the United States of America, we sent Eric Holder 2 DVDs of testimonies from the citizens in Brooks County that I have never made public yet. I've never published them publicly, but guess what's coming soon your way? To show that as it was in 1918, 1946, and 2015 is something about the black man, the black woman, and their children that some don't want you to know about.
Thank you. Roscoe Allen Jr.
My name is Roscoe Allen Jr. I think.
Mr. Allen, if you don't mind, would you just give us your address?
My address is, 765, physical address is 765 Issy Gresham Road, but I get my mail at P.O. Box 1906, Douglas, Georgia.
Okay. Thank you.
I do think the state need to put more heat on these supervisors and election board when it goes to vote. There's a lot of leak stuff going on. And the reason why it's going on is because y'all not putting the heat where they did. See, like every year, when it comes to election, the same thing happens, leave them the city, y'all don't do nothing about it. It's time to get and do something. So don't do nothing. It's a big problem in the state of Georgia, especially right around rural town like where I live at, in areas, it is a big problem. So y'all need to put the heat where it be at. You won't have all this problem, believe me. Anybody, no friend, whoever in charge, about doing what they're supposed to do. It's legal, they're doing it legal. It needs to be done right. It's a big problem in the state of Georgia. Believe me, down in my area, it's a serious problem. Every time election come up, it's always legal stuff going on with the election board. Supervisor, all of them. That's a fight. Because I subpoena people in elections that live in 20 miles out of the town. That's right, I did myself. 50 miles out of the town. Don't even live in the city there. You know, it's a big problem. I'm telling you now. Y'all need to put the heat with me. I don't care who it is. That's what y'all supposed to do. Am I right? Okay, that's all I got to say.
Thank you for being here this morning. And our last speaker during public comment, Reverend Larry O'Hara. Welcome, Reverend.
My name is Reverend Larry O'Hara. I reside at 1326 Roosevelt Street, Waycross, Georgia. I want to talk about Homerville, Georgia as well, but not just Homerville. I want to talk about all the little towns where the big problems are. Where you may say where Atlanta, Augusta, Columbus, that's where the city and that's where the most populated. But where the most populated is not where the problem is. The problem is little towns like Waycross, Homerville, Douglas, towns like that. The reason I'm talking about Homerville so much because I called the Secretary of State office several times myself. I've been calling for the last 10 years for voting fraud. Places like Willacoochee and Homerville. Homerville is so bad there that we caught this gentleman who resides in Florida, also resides in Georgia, but holding an office in a town that he don't have a domicile in. I called the Secretary of State office 3 months when we found out what he was doing and nothing was done about it. However, nothing was done about it. He went on and we went to their office. We talked to them, gave them the information that could not be denied, and they still allowed this man to run for office. And he was elected. Now that wouldn't happen in Atlanta. If I had went to a city commissioner office, a meeting in Atlanta, they would have stopped it right then. But this is little Georgia, little town, the town that nobody pays attention to. Mr. Secretary, what I'm asking is that you would pay more attention to the little towns, not so much the big towns. I believe a lot of your problems was the size. That's all I have to comment.
Thank you for being here, Reverend. Okay, anyone else? That was all the cards I had.
The witnesses lied on the stand.
Yes, yes, yes.
The Georgia Bureau of Investigation lied on the stand.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes.
Falsified documents.
That's right.
Yes.
The Secretary of State lied on the stand.
Yes. Sure
did.
Yes, yes.
Boone from the post office, who started this whole mess, lied on the stand.
Sure did.
Yes.
All to try to make these citizens look guilty.
City Hall, the Water Department, Police Department, whatever. I need all the keys.
Okay.
Okay?
So now, hold on just a second. So now, what do? I'm going to get myself. Now, what we can do is, you can meet me there.
I'll go with you to let you get your stuff.
Okay.
Okay?
Do you need help?
Yeah, because all my files and everything are in there. Okay. All right.
Here you go.
Okay, I sure will. All right. Okay, bye-bye. Good deal. I'm fine, I'm it.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So just hang.
Once again, this is the Ghetto Freak Press. Strange things happen in the state of Georgia. This is why I ask Governor Deal, Sam Olson, and others to step in. Once again, this is the Ghetto Free Press. I just happen to be here in Gordon at this time. This is the same thing that's happening in Meigs, Georgia. We have to understand that the Meigs mayor has been arrested twice. She has received two criminal trespass warnings. Each one of her brothers, Edward, I think have received two trespass warnings. Also, Calvin has received two. The mayor was kicked out of her office. Then they gave her another office. Then they locked the door to that office in Meigs, and she could not get in. You know, I've been saying what I've been saying for a long time. Georgia has some strange laws, and we had better get on top of this. All this is nothing more than to circumvent the voting process in the state of Georgia. Now, if you go back and Google and research Equipment 10 plus 2, what has happened in Meigs, Georgia, Gordon, Georgia, Davisboro, Georgia, Warrenton, Georgia, Dawson, Georgia, and others that I have been notified of, there is something seriously wrong here. And I can't understand why the Justice Department under Eric Holder, along with the Civil Rights Division, I cannot understand why they keep circumventing the voting process in the state of Georgia. I'm gonna say it again. Is there anybody in Georgia or in the United States Justice Department that are really concerned about voting rights here in the United States of America? This is the Ghetto Free Press. We do what we do because I served this nation for over 21 years, and I don't think this is the America that many of our active duty, disabled veteran, retired veteran, and common American citizen are happy with. Once again, this is the Ghetto Free Press.
I just witnessed my mom being served by the sheriff department. And they said relinquish all keys to any sealed in buildings, to City Hall, the annex, water authority, anything. He said that she could not go to her office in her capacity as mayor. And so, well, he then further stated after being questioned, you know, what could she do to retrieve her items? He said that she can go in, not as mayor, but as a regular citizen. So my thing of it is, they would serve her, what time is it?
Go ahead, just keep talking.
They served her just moments or a couple of hours before the city council meeting. It's 5:34. The city council meeting tonight is at 7:30. They served her because they're about to pay the auditor for services rendered. Now, I don't know what Councilman Edie has up his sleeve, or Tawana Brown, and the rest of them, but it's coming to a head. It has already come to a head. We, as the citizens of Gordon, need to know where the funds are. For too long, this city has shown no growth. And there's potential for many jobs to come to this area. They're trying to hold back progress. Councilman Edie, City Clerk Tawana Brown, Councilman Smallwood, Councilman Densley, they're holding up progress. They keep serving her these things.
Papers.
They keep serving her these papers so that she can get boggled down and not be able to do her job. Now, I don't know what they have up their sleeve tonight, but I think all of you as concerned citizens, I'm not talking about that group who call themselves concerned citizens, but I'm talking about the real concerned citizens of Gordon who elected her in. You're in the majority. You need to be down there at the city council meeting tonight to hear what's going down, because it's a hot mess right now, as I see it, a hot mess. NAACP, you need to be here. 100 Black Men of Macon, you need to be here. Concerned Black Men of Gordon, you need to be here. Concerned Black Women of Gordon, you need to be here. Ministers, elders, pastors, deacons, missionaries, evangelists, you need to be here at this city council meeting tonight to represent your city.
Concerned white right people as well.
I'm including it all.
Right, that's right, everybody.
Because I'm including everybody.
That's right, everybody.
Everybody.
That means well, right, and good.
Right. We're going for right. Amen. We're going for Mayor
Luke. This is the Ghetto Free Press. I'm George Boston Rhymes. As you can see, the news media wasn't out before, but they're definitely out tonight. And it all centered around getting her keys, turning in everything that she has to the city. And we all know that this is the same thing that has happened in Meigs, Georgia. Linda Harris, all of her information have taken. The news media is here. This is the same thing that happens in Meigs, Georgia.
Why no comment, ma'am?
Have you surrendered items yet from the city to the sheriff's office?
This is Gordon City. Gordon, Georgia. We know that this has been going on for a long time. This is in Gordon, Georgia. We have been saying to the governor, the state of Georgia, to take action about what is happening to the newly elected black mayors across the state. We have called on the Attorney General, Secretary of State, Eric Holder. And yet, these mayors continue to cry out. We have called for the civil rights leaders and others, and yet nothing changes. Everything remains the same. And once again, this is City Hall. I was there when the sheriff deputy came to serve papers on the mayor. We knew this would happen. It's nothing new. We must understand that we had to fight just to get a drink of water from a water fountain. And so the audit was asked for, and we see that just maybe people don't want that audit to be finished. I can see that many people are asking Mr. Whipperloo to talk, but I don't blame him. He has often tried to talk, and he said that his wife, they never expressed their views, and so I guess I kind of understand him not talking today. And it's the same thing in Meigs, Georgia, and other cities in the state of Georgia. Governor Nathan Deal have been informed of this, Secretary of State, Georgia Attorney General. And so we only waited for this to happen. We knew it was coming. It's nothing new. Listen, you have never heard me say.
Well, you, but the mayor said that.
You have never heard me say. See, I'm gonna keep you straight.
Right.
So that's my job.
The mayor said that, and in your interview, that was out, and you repeated back to her. So you feel like the media distorts the truth.
It's not about feeling. It's about a fact of reality. The facts of reality is, you can act like, you know, the facts of reality is, it's not me. It's a historic, documented record of what the media does in the Nation of Islam, and I'm not even a Muslim. Elijah Muhammad taught the black community that the media is no friend of certain segments of the American people. The same thing was said in Dr. King's most famous writings. He said the same thing. He talked about when we went to marching, he said the media wasn't there. When he talked about certain things in the war in Vietnam and how they were killing little children, that was Dr. King. So this is, I want you all to understand that this is nothing new for us. You see, nothing new.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, please, yes, sir.
Can you name an instance, a specific instance in which we destroyed the truth?
Well, see, you have to ask the mayor that. But what I'm speaking of now is that you look at the newspaper.
Newspaper are you referring to, please?
I'm talking about the Wilkinson.
Okay, again, though, we're not part of the Wilkinson Post. And when she made that comment, it was a blanket statement about the media. In town, she named all the other media, and again, we've never got the opportunity to sit down with Mayor Whipple and ask her questions. So, do you understand where I'm coming from, where I'm frustrated as a reporter because I can't do my job to get both sides of the story when only one side is willing to talk to me? Do you understand that?
Yes, I understand that. I understand it in Brooks County as well. The news media down there are caught up with the same thing. A lot of blacks won't talk to them because they don't trust them. See, go ahead. I'm gonna see how I do you. Go ahead. Talk. I'm gonna listen to you.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
So you said the NAACP was aware about
this. Oh, yeah.
Are they planning to turn it down?
I can't speak for them, but I will tell you that when this happened, I was there at the house of the mayor, and I got on the phone and called the state president, Edward DeBose, who is the former president of the NAACP. And I don't know where they're gonna take it, but the thing about it is that, as I said earlier, this is nothing new. They are aware of it. When we were at Morris Fort Bridge, I talked to Tyrone Brooks. Tyrone Brooks is very familiar with what's going on. Not only here, you see, and I know you all are focused on what you focus on. But see, we're looking at the big picture. It's very little need to really come by and address this one issue when you got 12 other cities going through the same identical thing. In fact, Meigs is worse than Gordon. It's worse than Gordon.
Unfortunately, it's not in our coverage.
And guess what? I got you. But guess what? Nobody's covered it.
You'd have to talk to the media down there.
I understand that. But see, I'm still in America. And when I served this country, I didn't just serve in Meigs or Brooks County. I served for everybody. You see what I'm saying? And that's what makes the difference. See, I'm concerned with everybody. I'm not as concerned with Gordon. And that's what makes it. And I'm connecting the dots. And there are people in Washington who are listening. And I believe on the I form of government, sooner or later, somebody's going to listen. I believe that. I sure do. With everything, because I love this country. I served in the Vietnam War, and I love this country. And because I love this country, it's why I do. You think my life ain't been a threat? Yes. And guess what? I enjoy it. When I call the Justice Department and they tell me what they're doing, they say, you know you're doing something. That's why I'm gonna do this until the end. I love everybody. I got professors at BSU. They are the ones that support me the most, and they white. It's not about a race thing for the most part. It's about living up to the founding fathers of this great republic. I love this nation.
You're saying it's not about race?
No, it's not about race.
So what is it about?
If you want this, and if you can get this, the Bible says, and people don't want that, but he said we fight not against flesh and blood. All races are flesh and blood. But he talked about powers and principalities of power and spiritual weakness in high places. And I'm not a very religious person. You follow me? But my point is that there always is something deeper than what you see. I was taught in my circles to look behind the hand of the hidden man.
So what's behind?
There's always another hand.
Who's the hidden man? Who's the hidden man?
That's what we're trying to find out. And hopefully through the court, he will be known. because truth will shine.
Well, I apologize if you felt like I was disrespecting you.
No, no, it don't bother me because okay. I've been through all that.
Well, I've been through all of that. I'm just giving you an apology.
I don't need it, but I appreciate it.
But I'm just offering it out to you to let you know well. I apologize.
Yeah.
You mentioned the courts. Can you tell me why Mayor Whipple wasn't in court today to testify on behalf of the hearing?
On the day when she had her hearing?
Today.
She didn't have a hearing today.
There was some sort of where the judge issued the order.
I think it was just an order. I don't think it was.
No, it did say order.
Oh, just an
issue. It wasn't a hearing.
She didn't know what it was about. I was there when she got it. She didn't know. I'm one insist to ask her to call her attorney before she signed
it. So, are you technically a member of the press, or are you an advocate for?
As I said earlier, I am an individual. I'm a blogger and I'm a YouTuber, and I've been doing it for a long time. When I found out that the news media, South Georgia, would not report the news, that's what started me doing this.
Okay.
And I got started, people appreciate it.
Gotcha.
Oh, what's your name?
George Ivan, Mayor George Ivan from Warrenton, Georgia.
Okay. And when were you elected to that office?
I was elected in November the 5th, okay. 2014.
Okay. What's the population of?
Our population is, in our city, 2,100 people.
Okay, I have highlighted many problems in 11 cities, and you're one of the cities that we have noticed. So, short form, give us our overview of what you've experienced since you were elected to office.
Right now, I came in, been elected, the citizen of Warrenton. I think we was one of joy at the time because we wanted to change there. And then through my knowledge that after I was elected, find out later on that the council and the previous mayor had went in and did a resolution and they had took the mayor power. They were saying that they had came in and did a resolution on December the 31st, 2013.
As far as you know, since you've been in office, was that legal in terms of getting with the power brokers in Atlanta?
From my knowledge, no. Okay. It was not legal.
Okay. Something I found out with other mayors is that they took their powers, some of them have gone into the court system. Family members have been arrested. Some of them have been put on a criminal trespass. Some of them are even afraid to come back in the city. Have you experienced any of that?
Well, I've been to court. They challenged my resident. They were saying that I didn't live in the place that I said I was living. And we went to court and I won that fight there.
How long was that?
This was in April.
And do you consider your administration any different from the previous mayors that may have served?
Yes, I do, because the mayor that served there, they had power and they could do different things. I do not have anyone seeing that they're working with me, because in making a change, and a lot of the changes that you have to make, you have to change people and you have to have people that are working with you. And right now it seems that I don't have anyone working with me at this time.
Okay, so as mayor, do you feel like you have a council that are in opposition to you, or they support you? Before I came to Georgia, I've noticed that there's usually a professional level of camaraderie between the council members and the mayor, if not a high level of respect for the mayor. Can you comment on that as far as your situation?
Well, respect, I don't feel that I get that respect, because I have my counsel. If something that I don't agree with them, you know, my counsel will get up and just walk out of the meeting. You know, if it's not their way, you know, I feel that they just walk out. And even to the citizen there, you know, I feel that every citizen, and there's a taxpayer and a voting citizen, their right is to ask what's going on with their funds in the city. And when we cannot see where our money is going, you know, there is question. And right now, we cannot see it.
Okay, most cities that I've been in, and I hope that the top wheels, the governor and the attorney general, know, will get a copy of this video. And what I've seen here in the state of Georgia, it seems like all of the problems most of the problem is centered around the access of invoices, bank statements, the budgets, and the money. Would you say the same thing exists in your city?
Well, some of the things I seen there, I'm trying to get an upper hand on, even with our PO number, you know, purchase order number, and I'm trying to get my council now the reason why we can see where our money's going, instead of just bring it in a piece of paper that's saying that they spent this amount of dollars certain places, and they don't have a purchase order on there. I think if we can look at our statement and find out where else money going, then we can use it more wisely that way in our city to help our city grow forward.
Okay. On February the 6th, 2015, I had just left Morris Bank in Gordon, and I was referred to by a group of whites. One was a city council member. I won't call his name, but I was called a nigger twice. Have you experienced any racial overtones? I know in, for instance, Lumpkin, Georgia, he has. So do you have that, or is it subtle, or is it not at all prevalent in your opinion?
Well, I have had those calls when I wanted to be mayor at the house that my daughter live in, and I tell them to answer the phone at this time now because my business is there also too. And I got phone calls, nigga mayor and stuff like that, you know, calling all times of night, you know, and threatened calls, they have been made, yes.
George Abbott, do you feel like the Secretary of State, Brian P. Kemp, Attorney General Sam Olens, Governor Nathan Deal, or any of the civil rights organizations have stepped up to the plate to assist you with what you are going through there in your city here in the state of Georgia?
No, because every time I reach out for help, the first thing I get, you don't have to get your attorney. And in a small town like that, you know, we don't have the funds because the city attorney is not working with me either. So I don't have the funds to just, you know, $10,000 or $20,000 to pay an attorney to defend the city of Warrenton. I would love to do that.
Do you think that what you have gone through may have just hindered blacks from coming out to vote during your election?
Oh yeah, because that's some of the things that some of the blacks say that when they come to city council, our African America, you know, they come there and in the council, you know, disrespect them and, you know, make them feel large, not large to anything. So now they get to a point that they don't want to come out because they are talked down, you know, and I think that's unjust and unfair to them. You know, I think every citizen should, you know, be able to speak their opinion, you know, voice their opinion to the people. And as the mayor, and I want them, my policy is I have an open policy that you can come in and talk to the mayor about any situation. And we have several situations that's what they do. They feel that they can, but when they come to council, they get shot down. They'll tell them they can't speak, or they'll tell them that you need to put it in writing, or something like that, you know. But the previous time, the only thing you have to do is just sign in, you come in and speak.
You had any citizen who have had trouble getting?
I had some that they'll say that they would ask them for records and they'll tell them to come by the office, and then when they go by the office, they're not ready, they have to keep coming back and forth to the office.
And I'm sure that you're aware of the handbook that the Georgia Attorney General put out about Sunshine and Open Records. You're familiar with that handbook,
yes, sir,
right? What do you think about that, the procedures for the people who voted you into office, and in regards to what is in that book for getting information about the city governmental operations?
I feel that they've been violated, you know, from that rule book of Sunshine, because some of the meeting they have that we're not aware, even the mayor is not aware of some of the meeting that they are having. Because even like when we went to court, they had a meeting after the court days and did some moving around funds and stuff, and it wasn't even posted.
So you are telling me something that I have already videoed from other mayors, and that is that you're left out of some of the procedures of the city governmental operations?
Yes, sir.
Do you think that's right?
No, sir. I know that's not right.
Okay, we're going to end this. I'll come back to you, but I want to leave you by asking this question. If you was going to ask anybody in this country for some assistance, who would be that person you would ask, and what would the question you ask them?
I would ask our state of Germany, will they send someone to Warrington to take a look at the things that are going on? Not just take me on my word or no one else. Please just come in and investigate. Because I feel that it's unlawful right now what's going on.
I have said, excuse me, give me your name and what city you are the mayor of.
Linda Easton Harris, and I'm the mayor of the city of Meigs.
Okay, I visited Meigs, unlike Mr. Ivy. I have been there and I've recorded. But today, I just want you to tell us what you've experienced since becoming mayor. When did you become mayor, by the way?
I was elected November 5th. I was sworn in January 2nd.
Okay. And so just tell us a little bit about your experience since you took office.
Okay, it hasn't been a good experience. As, like I stated, I was sworn in January 2nd and sworn in agenda number 3. On agenda number 4, I was ousted out. And short council meeting, I went the next day and I sought legal counsel, and several attorneys told me they didn't think that was the proper thing to do. They thought that the charter had been violated, and we found out it had been violated, so they had to give me the keys to the office. On that day, I went in January 3rd, about 2 o'clock, and the employees who were there still didn't want to give me the keys, but they, you know, had to be forced to give me the keys. And the ladies that I hired in there to help me with administrative daily operations, they actually like turned on me in about 2 weeks, and it was like financial situations. After we found out we didn't have as much money as we thought we had from previous misappropriations of funds, I told them, well, I'm sorry, I don't think we're gonna be able to pay y'all the rate that we had agreed to pay y'all. And from that day on, it was a turnaround, because you know people don't want you to bother their money. So the lady I hired as the city clerk, she spoke to the city attorney, and the city attorney advised her on how to get with a council who didn't vote for me anyway, and to take my powers away from me. And that happened February 6th. They had a private meeting, one-on-one meeting. And on February 10th, that Monday, they were having a meeting to take my powers away by ordinance.
Now, when you say February the 6th, now, if that was an illegal meeting, did anybody notify the state representatives, since they profess that they want open meetings and sunshine laws?
No.
Nobody said anything?
Nobody said anything.
But even after you identified that something was wrong, and you did notify somebody in Atlanta, am I correct? The representative, the senator, something
yes,
like that?
Yes, I immediately called, found out who our representatives were, and called Sam Watson, and had a meeting with him, and he was to look at over the charter, and then he got with our representative, Jay Powell, and don't know exactly what happened. It wasn't any results, however. Then I called Atlanta. Reached out to Sam Olin's office and also to Governor Deal's office, and they tell me that what we have in Meigs is an intergovernmental mess, and that I'm going to have to get me an attorney. So it's been over a year now, and I'm still fighting it, still being forced to have my office, in and out of office, powers taken.
Okay, when you say powers taken, did they take those powers with the approval of the state of Atlanta? Because I think that whenever they change governmental law, whether it's a strong mayoral type government or city manager, I thought that the state of Georgia, you have to go through a process. You just can't do it arbitrarily.
Well, you have to go through the state legislators. Mm-hmm. And what I'm dealing with, however, is an incompetent council. They don't know that they're supposed to do that. And I've advised them that that is the procedure. But with them getting illegal advice from our city attorney, they feel that they're doing the right thing. But no, they haven't gotten any kind of, they think they can do it by local act. And it's clearly in the state law that you can't do it by a local act, nor resolution, nor ordinance.
Okay, I'm gonna ask you the same question I've been asking some of the other mayors. How do you feel that they are treating you as a mayor among your own council?
I'm totally being disrespected. I have the city clerk, city manager, the council. They'll come in and they'll tell me, Mayor, you don't have power to do this. And I've had the new city manager to come in and snatch bank books away from me as I try to look in them to make sure that everything has a paper trail. And they've given him the authority to do the mayor the way he wants.
Doretha, if you remember correctly, you and Barbara missed about 8 or 9 meetings in a row last summer.
If you're going to print something in your paper, I really appreciate that you would not put untruth in there. Please put the truth in there. I missed 2 meetings. Thank you.
And so did I, 3 at the most.
No, ma'am.
You are.
Don't stare at me. Turn around. You don't need to stare at me.
I'd like to ask a question. We've been told that they
say
we're
not
staring. I can't do that because they do it to me.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
So my question is, you're under the citizens of talking time, and are you appearing as a citizen of Gordon or as a journalist, or how are you appearing here? If you're appearing as a journalist, why does the mayor stop me from speaking?
Madam, I go to a lot of cities. I'm very familiar with the laws of addressing city council. I have no idea, but I will say this. If the mayor stopped you from doing what I'm doing tonight as a journalist, the Get Two Free Press, under the name of Joy Boston Rhymes, if she stopped you after you put in the request to speak as I put in the request, she is wrong in my opinion. If you put in a request tonight, I think that you have a right to be doing the same thing that I'm doing, and I wish you would have. Now that's just the way I see it. Jesus said, what I say unto one, I say unto all. And so if you can't do it unto all of us, don't do it into any of us.
Don't put your hands on me. Engagement letter is my date. The mayor signed it on the date that she signed it. She wrote down the date that she signed it. So it's effective the date that the mayor signed it, which is what? I think it's 2/19 or 2/17.
2/19.
So what is your question? Any other questions?
It has not been voted on. It has never been voted on.
It was voted on 2 weeks ago.
And what happened?
You abstained.
And
why did you abstain? I'd like to know.
Because I am not satisfied with the way you have been carrying this audit forward. There's too many discrepancies and too many things that I don't know. You have left a lot of this council out of the picture. You have purposely talked with a few people, like Mr. Reese, maybe the mayor, but you have never asked me any questions that I could might help you with. You have kept me in the dark. Okay? I've talked with you. We've had conversations.
Yes, we have had conversations. I have had conversations with someone.
Yes,
what are you asking me?
And I told you then, until everything was legal, that everything you had done was not up to par because it was not legally voted on. And it still has not been voted in. An abstention is a no vote. Doesn't count. One way or the other. 3 yeses, 2 noes, and an abstention, or 2 abstentions, and a no and 3 yeses does not pass a motion at this table. It takes 4 yes votes. Always 4 yes votes.
Okay. So, So last, or 2 weeks ago, you abstained?
Yes,
sir. And why did you abstain?
Because I just told you, everything is not legal. I can't go any further than that. That is exactly the reason. It is not legal what we have done and what you have done up to this point.
I have to.
And please.
Chair, I have a problem with this because it is not legal. I'm very ticked off. Why did we let him work here 13 days? Why didn't somebody interrupt and say, stop this, we're not going to do it no more? You don't let somebody work 13 days. I don't let you cut 2 acres of my grass and tell you I don't need you.
Amen.
Now, if it were illegal, you should have been stopped from the store. Now, I'm going to force my 2 cents while I got this opportunity. I kept my mouth shut. There are a lot of discrepancies with this city plan. Not what you say, but what I've seen and read over before. We talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars apparently misappropriated or not counted for. We need some answers. I don't think he's leaving you out for seeing. It's no different when Right and Right doing audit. Right and Right never told us what went on in the audit. We sat at this table and the mayor presented what was going on. But then they met and discussed whatever. And I asked to assist or work with Mr. Bassett because I was familiar with a lot of the things, a lot of the people, a lot of the contractors, by name and stuff, which he would not know. And he has had resistance from day one. The first day he came, he had to do this audit. We sat over there all day and could not do the audit when they met over here with the EEOC and the attorneys. Now, one attorney, when the mayor come back, he didn't get any information. He was here to do that audit. And the only way he got information then, there was some EEOC attorneys that went in when Mr. Bassett asked to get a copy of the file on her computer. She didn't know how to unload or download to his disk. One of the EEOC attorneys said, that's no problem. Ever since he got that, Mr. Boone had been contending that he has tampered with the file, he has done things inappropriately. There's some stuff on those files that we can print for everybody to see.
Right.
Yeah.
Because there are things going on here that need to be addressed by an office.
And I can't, attorney.
I'm not going to stand here and let me make accusations.
You, attorney, if you can't sit, then you need to exit.
Are you going to let him speak? And not
yes,
me?
Yes, he's a council member, and you're not.
And he's allowed under the law to defend himself.
No, he's not even working.
He's not even working.
You're out of order. Chief, I need you to come. If y'all can't retain yourself, you need to exit.
Well, then you
this is according to the
you
law.
Need to make, you need to.
He's attorney, please have a seat.
No, but he's not shielded from the slander law by telling stories.
My name has been slandered, so have a seat.
Amen.
My name has been slandered in all of this. Now, y'all don't want me to get started. Resume.
The council first voted on the audit. You had 6 council members were present, and you had 5 voted for the audit, and 1 voted against the audit. It is rumored that one person made a statement to another member, you are a disgrace to the white race. Well, if that's not racist, I don't know what is. He also said, and I quote, if I go to jail, you are going to go to jail also. So why you want to support it? Those statements have never been put on the air, on in the news, in the newspaper, in the Wilkinson Post. I'm wondering why. I spoke to Channel 41 about it, and their comment was, and I quote, I understand, I was there, I heard it, I was on tape, but from our vantage point, it is not newsworthy. And that will tell you exactly what I'm saying.
So now, Mr. Liu, what you are saying is that, I mean, when you first started, my question to you was, is this a figment of your imagination? But now you have stated on camera before the people and citizens in Gordon, in the state of Georgia, and for Eric Holder of the Department of Justice that also have a civil rights division that deals with racial issues, you making it unequivocally clear that somebody witnessed what was said, yet our newspapers have ignored or said that it was not newsworthy, when in, let me repeat, when in Lumpkin, Georgia, a white female city councilman allegedly referred to Mayor Gibson, and I went and covered the story because I was called to that area, referred to him as a nigger. They told me, don't use the N-word, but call it what it is because we're at 2014. So you're saying what you just said has been, can be substantiated and verified by certain individuals. Who else was there that saw or heard what you were saying?
I would say the mayor reported it, number one, at the meeting.
Okay.
Nobody.
Okay, so this was at a public meeting?
Yes.
City council meeting?
City council meeting. And that was not record, that was not put in the minutes.
Wait a minute. You're saying that somebody is not putting the beef of the minutes in the minutes?
Amen. That's exactly what I'm saying.
Tawana Brown.
What's her name?
City clerk.
Go ahead. What's her name?
Her name is City Clerk Tawana Brown. I was there at that meeting when Mayor Lou discussed that. She said point blank that Tara Eady made a comment to City Council Member Smallwood.
Thomas Smallwood.
Exactly. Said that, you ought to just paint your face black. Now, if that's not a racist comment, I don't know what is. Do we want a person of that nature, of that character, being Mayor Pro Tem for us? Do we want that person to step up? Now, they got a good one, Mayor Lou. Now they're trying to put in, what? A disgrace. We support Mayor Lou.
We support the mayor.
I just heard that somebody said, no bill. What was the verdict?
No bill.
No bill.
No bill. Okay. To Basil, no bill, honey.
No bill.
I wish you could be here to hear it.
Yes.
Basil.
So I ask you again, Madam Mayor, where do you think this will end? And I mean the overall situation. Where do you think that it just may end?
To be honest, the devil continues. I style it as Satan himself. He goes and he comes. It'll be only something else. But as I always say, God be the glory.
Okay.
He has sustained me, and he will continue to sustain me.
Okay.
And I look to him.
Okay. I heard you say something earlier that it has been a month since your husband passed.
Yes.
How do you feel about him possibly not being here? I know he would have been here with you. And what's your take on the fact that he's not here? And there's a possibility that I have said, trying to be independent, but that some of the stress may have led to his demise.
It certainly did, 100%. The fact of seeing me travail and continuously go through these bogus charges is enough to weigh on anybody. It causes physical as well as mental stress. But, you know, with all of that, I've had to look to God, who is my sustainer, who has sustained me through all of this.
Yes.
Because anybody else who had been put through all of this, there's no way in hell on the side of heaven they would have been able to withstand.
Yes.
And I say to this, to God be the glory, and everything belongs to him.
Mm-hmm.
And he is the reason why I do what I do.
Yes.
And I say that my husband was a strong supporter of me. He believed in me. And I believed in him. He loved me, and he trusted what I was doing, and I trusted what he was doing. And to see that taken advantage, I will continue to fight for the plight and stand for what is right, as I've been elected by the people to be the voice for the people. It matters not about black and white, black or white. It's about doing the right thing. These people have blighted our town. They've taken everything and stripped us of it. They want to strip me of my dignity and my respect. They stripped me of the right for my husband. And I will never, ever give up. Thank you.
Well, Madam Mayor,
one more thing, please. I know this is hard for you, but I want you to answer this question because I was here at the first time when Ms. Wells was here, and you had a witness that was here, and for some reason, that witness actually witnessed what took place, and she was never called to stand before the grand jury. And I mean, what do you think about that? Is anybody having any comments? Why do you think? Do you have any comments on that, Elijah?
I would say it's just like any other place. These indictments that brought against the mayor is just to downgrade her. They don't want her in the position that she's in. And whenever she has anyone that wants to stand strong beside her to help support her, this legal system is not going to let them come forward to voice their views on what issues that has happened. The mayor has endured some of the worst abuse anyone could have to go through. She have lost her husband, and people don't even have dignity enough to give her the respect to mourn the way a woman should mourn without having all these problems behind her. We here to support the mayor. No matter what they do to try to down her or bring her down, she has supporters. And I'm one that gonna support her until the very end. No matter what, because this is one strong woman, and she's a woman that's about our town. These few people that's downing her and everything has an agenda.
That's
and
right.
People don't know what this agenda is, but I would like to tell them. They've been stealing from this town for so long that they don't want people to know what's been going on. But the simple fact is, this lady came into office and she asked them for a forensic audit. This is where everything came down on her at, because she asked for a forensic audit so people will know that she don't have anything to hide when she come in office. She wanted the book open so she'll know where the money is and what's being done, this and that. When you get that type of thing and ask, if you're a criminal, you're going to try your best to stop it no matter what. And that's what's happening.
That's right.
And I'm going to tell you the main one, and I don't mind calling name, but I keep from calling name, though, but that city of God know who is prosecuting our mayor. They know who behind it.
That's it.
And that's my statement.
And we're going to continue to support her, and they're going down. I mean, they're going down. I mean, no sympathy, no nothing. You know, they have stole long enough. So, what goes up is coming down.
Okay. Anyone else have anything to say?
Yes, we support. This is my mother. Mm-hmm. We support her wholeheartedly. We understand that God has been sustaining her. Their thing is to wear her down mentally, physically, and spiritually. But you cannot shake the Spirit of God, okay? He that is within us is greater than anyone who can be in this world. So all these chantings, you know, all these secret meetings, you know, all of this, it's nothing to us. It doesn't mean anything to us. You can do it all day, all night if you choose to, but we serve the one and only true living God. And we know that He is the author and finisher of every single faith. And if they don't get themselves together, I don't care which side you're on, right or wrong, if you don't get yourself together before that final day, that final call, and you have to stand before the Lord and give your account of what you did and did not do. My mother, she's a good one, because she's not going to allow those bad things that they do to shake who she is, because she has to give an account for her reaction to every action. And so she's got us, and we're going to lift her up like they did for Moses. They lifted his arms up and they kept him, and we're going to continue to lift our mother up, our sister up, our community leader up, because she is the mayor of Gordon. And she will continue to be the mayor of Gordon. And I really, you know, ask that other leaders in Gordon and in the county, they step up and show themselves strong, because you have the power. It has always been in your hand. Use it.
Okay. Two questions, and I don't care who answers this question. Number one.
I'd like to hear from my mother, George, the friend.
Would you like to say that same thing?
Well, I can't say this. She's my daughter. And as a mother, and who, how many mothers could stand up, and like I said, and just see how the people are ridiculing her? No, I don't like it. I don't like it, not name B.
Now, everybody knows that there is a problem in the state of Georgia on circumventing the power of the black vote, as well as removing mayors from public office. It is approximately 12 cities. So now, the people here are fully aware, I'm sure, that this is indeed a high-profile case. Somebody, anybody, tell me why would not the television stations from the Middle District of Georgia, why would not this case and what the mayor is going through, why is it?
I can answer that.
Okay.
Wholeheartedly. If you go back to the civil rights, the power of the media was very influential in the movement then. And I believe that people have gone back and taken a look at that. And they've said, if we shed the limelight on her, on the Quitman 10 plus 2, and on the other places, then the media will cause an influx of sympathy and support in every shape, form, and fashion to come through. And so now you have those in control of the media that only want to scandalize and increase the drama for ratings.
Yes.
And just pocket. Because they're in that position to... not show what's really going on, okay? And you have journalists who want to show the real thing, but their hands are tied because their boss has said, we can't do these things. You know, they have meetings on this, okay? Mm-hmm. And we've heard them say it. They've had meetings on this. And no one can really say what they really want. No one can do what they learned in journalism school because their hands are tied by the one who signs their paycheck. And so that's what we are, and that's why they refuse to show what's really going on, because they know the influential possibilities of the media showing the limelight on what's really going on.
Well, thank you very much. Anybody else? Because I just love our nation, and our nation is based on freedom of speech, freedom of the press, freedom of religion, and all of this. But when we fail to keep the citizenry informed, in my most humble opinion, as a retired military veteran, I ask the question, why is our sons and daughters serving in foreign nations of the world when they return home, like I returned, from the Vietnam era veterans, and I see mothers, black fathers, elected by a majority vote in the state of Georgia, and they cannot serve out the tenure for which the people elected them to. And before I close, I want to say this. I'm talking about in Quitman, Georgia. I'm talking about in Lumpkin, Georgia. I'm talking about in Warrenton, Georgia. I'm talking about in Davisboro, Georgia. I'm talking about Gordon, Georgia. I'm talking about Willacoochee, Georgia. I'm talking about Meigs, Georgia, with Linda Harris, and it is amazing, and yet the leaders here in the state of Georgia seem as if though they're just going to single out Mayor Marianne Whipple, when they know for a fact that we have 11 to 12 other cities. And 2 weeks ago I just had Hancock County to come up and meet with me, and that's on video as well. Madam Mayor, and all those who spoke, and all those who stand in support, and especially the mother, thank you so much. As a member of the press and as a citizen journalist, I do this because I believe in our form of government, and I do believe that the United States of America is the best nation on the face of the earth today. but it can only be as good as the people make it and continue to fight to keep the beacon of hope alive for the free world. Thank you very much.
This council person, this is not her first time referring to as black people as niggas.
Wait. Now you talking Miss Councilman Stone.
Councilman Stone.
Wow.
You know.
If it's not, excuse me, I got to join you, girl. This thing, okay. I mean, I already know we had problems in other cities. Now, this is more of a reason why the governor and the secretary of state and the attorney general needs to be here. If not the federal government.
Right.
Because you're dealing with civil rights here. So you. What has happened other than this incident?
Well, She has made the comment, and people have heard her saying that she grew up calling black people niggas. So there's nothing wrong with that, you know. And part of the reason why she's an elected official is because us as black people, some of us did not vote. I would like to tell America to take off the blinders. I would like to tell Governor Deal and any of the people up there that we elected to, they need to take the blinders off and come and see what's going on in their communities. Enough is enough, and that's it. We're not taking it away.
Can't go back in the city hall?
She can go back in the city hall as a citizen, not as a mayor.
So
you cannot. You can go to the city council meeting, but not as a mayor.
That's what
I said. This is what this is all about.
This is the Ghetto Free Press, and we just understand that undoubtedly. They saying she can not go back as mayor. It seems as if though what they've been doing in Meigs is not applicable here in Gordon. They say she can go to City Hall but not as mayor this evening. And they waited until right before the meeting tonight.
There's a lot of cash that runs through them here for the water bills. The people can say they pay the bills in cash. Cash is very risky thing to pay your bills with, because that allows the possibility of easier to steal. It's cash easier to take. Okay, I just want to make, if nothing else ever happens to this whole city, I would just like to tell you people, stop paying your water bills with cash. Write a check. Nobody can steal your check. Not really very easily, but they can pocket your cash a lot easier than that. Okay, so just don't do that anymore. There's thousands of dollars being paid that way. Okay. You can pay any way you want to, but I just recommend you don't.
That's really all. I guess I'm trying to think of anything else. I just want to make sure. The thing is, you got to vote yes or no. That state vote means you have to give a profit. You have a situation. Either, the way I understand, I did some research on this to find out what an abstention vote means. It means either have a conflict of interest. This is part of it. That's what I'm buying for. Either have a conflict of interest, or you have an interest, you have the person's answer to that. So I came here to answer your questions. Anything you have, as best I can, I probably revealed too much that I'm wanting to anyway. But I'm here to answer any questions, so you can either vote yes or no and make a decision on that. Okay? So is there any more questions?
There's one more. The day we was in that hearing, Ms. Taylor Hunt came up to me with your card in her hand, and she told me that the NAM was going to pay your expenses. Has that happened?
No.
Well, she told me they were.
I wish she'd gone through with it.
She's got a lot of things
that they can
hear about.
Okay. I'm just asking.
Is she here? You got a check for me?
I paid for some materials that you needed. I did an open request for some records that you needed, and they have not provided them. And I have called the Attorney General, and he told me by Wednesday, if I don't have them, that we're going to sue.
Some of the things that she's asking for are those checks, the back of the deposit slips. I have not. She's asked for them. How long ago was that?
I sent a request in July the 20th. I got an answer back on the 28th. I spoke with Mr. Green, and he said that she was going on a vacation, Ms. Brown, and would be back on the 4th. The assistant clerk could work on it, but she's got all the duties to do, and if the mayor permitted her, she could work on it and produce some of it. Well, the 4th came, I came up 3 days later, and Ms. Brown refused to give me any information. I paid for it, paid for a big portion of it, $230-something, and then I have only gotten 3 of the 17 items.
Where were you supposed to pick up those?
According to the open records, I'm supposed to pick them up with the people of the records, and according to the open records request, after I read the document, the keeper of the records for Gordon, Georgia is the city clerk, and that's where I was going to pick them up. Now, she was saying I need to contact Attorney Boone. I told her no, that she was the keeper of the records, and that's where I would be receiving them from Gordon. Now, if she wanted to go to Irvington and pick them up, if they were over there, then if they were being kept in Irvington, then I needed to notify the State Department that the records are not kept here, that they're kept in Irvington. And if I had to get them from Irvington, she need to go get them and bring them here because I was told to pick them up at the City Hall and go.
See, I have a problem with having those document requests be picked up in Irvington. I don't know why they're not picked up at City Hall. I don't understand. In Irvington, does that mean it's your office? Are you receiving these things?
Well, with all due respect, sir, as she's already pointed out, she has made this the subject of an open investigation by the Attorney General's office. It is an open investigation now. We are answering it to the Attorney General's office. So I'm not going to comment on an open investigation by the Attorney General's office.
Well, that's fair enough. But I think that if somebody asks an open records request, the documents come from the City Hall, not from anywhere else.
That's
because
right.
I'd want to see the documents straight from the source without anybody else having their hands on them. Okay? That's all I have to say.
This is not Satan's fight. I'm asking all righteous people, don't pray for Satan to stop his war, because this is not Satan's war. I want you to pray a prayer every day and meditate at least 30 minutes a day, preferably an hour. I want you to ask God, say, God, my prayer is that your will be done as I know it will be. But Lord, make the pain bearable for those who fight against you. Lord, don't make their suffering too great. That's the prayer I want you to pray for. Pray to God about.
Where is hatred? There's something about hate that hurts the hater.
Yeah.
Somebody must have the power to transform through love.
Yeah.
You just hate somebody.
Yeah.
And you are as uncomfortable and as frustrated as the person you hate.
Yeah.
Oh, hate. There's something about hate that keeps you from walking straight. Something about hate that keeps you from standing up straight. When you hate, you can't see right. When you hate, you lose your power of objectivity. If you hate somebody, you can't see that person. When you hate strong enough, the ugly becomes beautiful, and the beautiful becomes ugly. A good speech becomes a bad speech, and a bad speech becomes a good speech.
Yeah, yeah.
When you hate strong enough, you will look at a good deed of a person and call it a bad deed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hate causes you to put the wrong price tag on everything.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you hate strong enough, hairpins begin to sell for $1,000 in diamond rings for 5 cents.
Yeah.
Because you got the wrong price tag on them. Something about hate. Something about hate. It does something to the hater. So our way must be a way of love. We will stand up right here in this Southland and say to our white brothers,
We cannot in all good conscience obey your unjust laws. Do to us what you want to, and we're going to still love you, but we're going to disobey these unjust laws. And when you put us in jail, we're going to still love you. Whatever you do to us, we're going to still love you. Do to us what you will, and we're going to still love you. Have we come to that point yet? That we can use the power of our soul to transform the world.
Yeah.
Now somebody's saying to me, Reverend, what in the world do you mean when you say love your enemies? Love those people who are oppressing you. Do you mean to say you can love those people with an affectionate love? No, I don't mean that. I can't have an affectionate feeling for people who bomb my home, trying to kill my wife and my baby, and I can love them with this affectionate love, sentimental love, certainly not.
Yep.
You know, the Greek language has three words for love, and it's a very interesting thing how it applies to our situation. The Greek language has a word called eros, and eros is a sort of aesthetic love. Plato talks about it a great deal in his dialogues, the yearning of the soul for the realm of the gods. It has come thus to be a sort of romantic love, a sort of love that we have in our romantic relations. And so we all know about that kind of love. We all know about it. We have all been a part of eros. I guess Edgar Allan Poe was talking about eros when he talked about his beautiful Annabel Lee with a love surrounded by the halo of his sense. I mean, Shakespeare was thinking about eros in a sense when he said, love is not love, it alters when its alteration finds, offends with the remover to remove. It is an ever-fixed love that looks on tempest and is never shaken. It is a star to every wandering bog. You know, I can remember that because I used to quote it to my wife when we were courting. And the Greek language talks about philia, which is another love, another level of love. This is a sort of personal affection. It's a sort of reciprocal love. It's an affection between personal friends. And on this level, you love because you are love. You love people that you like. People that you have things in common with, you go have dinner with them, you talk with them on the telephone, they are likable people, and you have things in common, and they are your personal friends. This is a powerful love. Then the Greek language comes out with another word. It calls it agape. Agape is more than eros, it's more than philia. Agape is understanding, creative, redemptive goodwill for all men. It is an overflowing love which seeks nothing in return. Theologians would tell us that it is the love of God working in the lives of men. When you rise to love on this level, you love men not because you like them.
Amen.
But you love them because God loves them.
Amen.
I think this is what Jesus meant when he said, love your enemies. And I'm glad he didn't say, like your enemies. He didn't say, like your enemies. Because like is a sentimental, affectionate sort of thing. But love is greater than like. I find it pretty difficult to like all of these Southern senators and congressmen up in Washington who are doing everything that they possibly can to defeat the goals of the Negro. I don't like their ideas. We'll be right back.
go to.
Mary, are you going to join us?
Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus, we come right now, Lord. Just thank you, Lord, for giving us this opportunity. Lord, we pray right now, Lord, that you hear our prayer, Heavenly Father, that we know that you already will. You will do all things you say you will do.
Yes.
And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for the protection right now for these ladies and men. We fight for thy people, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
Lord, for the justice and the rightness for our city. We pray right now, Lord, you continue to bless each and every one of these mayor, Heavenly Father, the fight that they're going through. Let them know, Lord, that you'll be there every step of the way with them, yes. Heavenly Father. We pray, Lord, for this man of God, oh Heavenly Father, that he come out to help us out, Heavenly Father, and join us around.
Yes.
We pray for him, Lord, and we ask you to give him more power and strength to keep on that journey, oh Heavenly Father. Even when it's been threatened and been talked about, oh Heavenly Father, we ask you to give him a mind to stay focused on you, knowing that things are going to be all right. Bless each and every one of our home that we come from right now, Lord. Give us traveling grace back and up and down the dangerous highway. Until we meet again, oh Heavenly Father, we give you all the praise and we give you all the glory. And we just thank you, Lord, for this event. In Jesus Christ's name we pray.
Amen.
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 It is.
Amen.
As we coming back, we coming for a meal. You want to bring Sister Linda up your way. He knows how to do it.
Okay.
And
another suggestion, just to get together with the other mayors,
right,
to make it more convenient to...
think I have a coat in the car. George, thanks, George, for everything you're doing.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm gonna melt.